In 1977, producer-director George Lucas created the Star Wars trilogy and changed the way we looked at movies. Now, 20 years later, using new digital technology, Lucas and his creative teams at Lucasfilm, THX, Skywalker Sound, and Industrial Light and Magic have completely restored, enhanced, and added to these classic movies to create the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition.
The original inspiration for bringing the film out again was the fact that it was the 20th anniversary of the original release of the film.
I want to learn the ways of the Force and become a Jedi like my father.
I had an ulterior motive that I'd been thinking about for a long time, actually ever since the films were finished, which is there were various things, especially in the original film, that I wasn't satisfied with. Special effects shots that never really were finished, scenes that hadn't, you know, that I'd wanted to include that couldn't have been included for some reason, mostly money and time. And I really wanted to fix the film and have it be completed. The most obvious thing that's happened is we've gone back to the original negative, cleaned it up considerably, redone a lot of the optical effects, the wipes, the dissolves, and improved the quality of the film because it was deteriorating. And I think this one had deteriorated a lot more than anybody expected in 20 years. So you're getting to see a brand new print that's very clean and is actually better than the original release.
The actual original negative, it was so far gone that unless we actually did this at this time, we were never going to have the film to be able to release ever again.
I got him!
Great kid! Don't get cocky!
I definitely did the movie on the seat of my pants. I didn't really know what I was doing. I mean, I had some experience in animation. I knew how to make movies. And, you know, I knew that I was going to attempt to do something that had never been done before.
To try and do a multi-generational modern-day myth had not been done as far as I knew.
I brought you here. Now what?
We have to find the rebels. What we're carrying belongs to them.
The script was unlike any I'd ever seen before.
He had borrowed from Wizard of Oz or Kurosawa films, or, you know, he's just steeped in film lore. So it just sort of went through his pores, and that's how he imagines things. George has an extraordinarily visual imagination.
The first one was done under extreme conditions. It was very low budget, and it was very challenging to get it done in the amount of time, considering we had to invent a lot of new technologies and do all kinds of things that had never been done before.
We didn't even know if we could do the job and get it done in the time that we had to do it. We didn't know if we could make it look real or not, if it was going to look like most of the other science fiction films that had been done that looked pretty fake. So it was a problem of trying to come up with a look that could allow George's vision to get on the screen and be executed for the amount of money and for the time that we had.
One of the things that impressed me on all the movies was the way George could take scotch tape and popsicle sticks and really make something out of it. When I went, I had visions of what it would look like to see the Death Star blow up. And they had the equivalent of, say, 6 ping pong tables in the parking lot somewhere in the valley with all the tchotchkes glued to the surface, all these model kits. I mean, they cannibalized thousands of battleship kits and just glued them all on, and they were making passes on it with, you know, somebody just driving a Jeep. And of course that's the footage of the TIE fighters flying past the surface.
The essence of the storytelling had to be sacrificed for the limits of technology. George had very specific shots that he wanted to be able to achieve, but it was extremely difficult to do that with models on wires. So although for us in 1977, when we first saw it, it was still powerful, it was still big, he never got visually the dynamic shots that he actually wanted to get. So we've redone those.
I've taken a lot of the special effects shots that weren't really as good as I'd hoped they would be, because they were sort of prototype technology, and I've been able to improve them and just add that little difference, and I've done it with a lot of the end battle shots.
You know, you can actually see them. They come straight over camera, they go underneath camera, we can pan with them, you can see the pilots inside of them, you can see their heads moving. That was a real challenge, but a really, really a great deal of fun to do.
Great shot, kid! That was one in a million!
Mos Eisley was one of the scenes that actually prompted this whole adventure of redoing the movie. Because there were some scenes in there with the speeder that was obviously supposed to float across the landscape. And in the Mos Eisley sequence coming up to the cantina, they never really accomplished that. And all the best they could do was to put some Vaseline on the lens to kind of fudge out the wheels under the car. But it didn't look like it was floating. It was sitting right on the ground. And there was this sort of orange blob underneath it that was, we jokingly called the force field. That combined with the fact that I wanted to have Mos Eisley to be more exotic and to be larger and have spaceships and more creatures running around and more like a real city, is what really prompted a lot of this redo on the film. So we designed a series of shots which show Mos Eisley in a much grander scale. We pull back and see the whole city. We see a lot more beasts of burden moving around in the city, more activity, and it just gives you a better sense of what Mos Eisley is.
One of the things we were concerned with right from the beginning was we certainly didn't want it to suddenly look like a brand new, different-looking shot every time we dropped in one of the redos or improved or new shots. So a broad category of the new work we've done is to take the original elements that were used to comprise the shots and recombine them now using mostly computer technology.
When you're creating a world, part of what you do is whimsy and part of what you do is for plot movement and part you do just for your own personal interest and psychological eccentricities. I think Dubaks were put there out of whimsy. I wanted to give a kind of random real world feel to everything. So I wanted to do some things that weren't predictable, like having stormtroopers ride on Dubaks. In the original movie, in order to get Dubaks and things into the movie, we built a large rubber mannequin, really, that we were able to move around from set to set. He had a big stick in his head that somebody could sit alongside and move the head back and forth, and that was about as much movement as I could get out of it. And I always wanted them to have movement and walk around and be part of the population of the film. I added the Jabba the Hutt scene with Han Solo, which was a scene that had been cut out due to time and money constraints. And once I finished the third film, I really wanted to go back and put that back in there because it was sort of relevant to what happens to Han Solo at the end of the movie. And I really wanted to be able to connect the first film with the third film the way it was meant to be.
Right here, Jabba.
I've been waiting for you.
The scene was originally shot with an actor playing Jabba the Hutt to stand in for whatever creature we designed. Originally, I thought Jabba the Hutt would be kind of a furry character like Chewbacca. But as we went on and I redesigned him for Return of the Jedi, he obviously became a large slug and a very different kind of character. So we had to figure out a way of fitting that design into the original scene.
The ultimate goal is to make it look like Jabba was on the set talking to Harrison Ford, and we just photographed it. The plan was for us to remove this actor and replace him with Jabba. He had to be physically in that space where this actor was.
This project here was about 5 shots, took about a year to do. We take the picture of some of the stuff we found. We use some of the off-the-shelf software to build a 3-dimensional wireframe mesh. Then the next process is actually paint the creature. And with the painting of the creature, it also involves the actual texture of the surface of the characters.
We got to a certain point where everything was set, but there was one problem. Han Solo walks around Jabba.
We had to somehow shift Han. It would have been literally impossible for him to walk behind the Jabba character because of the tail. So George had the idea, so why don't you have him step on his tail?
Even I get bored sometimes.
You think I... At some point, a famous filmmaker said, films are never completed, they're only abandoned. And rather than living with my abandoned movie, I really wanted to go back and complete it.
You're all clear, kid. Now let's blow this thing and go home.
Stand by.
Now, sit back and get ready to experience George Lucas's definitive vision with the first installment of the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition.